Hello everyone, in this lecture today I'm going to talk to you about how microRNA or simply miRNA silence the gene. That is what I'm going to discuss in this lecture. I'm going to talk about their basic introduction. I'm going to talk about how these miRNA are biosynthesized and also how they actually regulate the gene expression. So basically these microRNA, they are small non-coding RNA which are about 21 to 25 nucleotide in length. This is the first important point. They are endogenous, of course, and they are small because they have only 21 to 25 nucleotide in length size, and they are non-coding, so they don't make proteins, okay? So this is the first introductory point. The next point is that these microRNA, they are actually master regulator of several genes. So they regulate the expression of several genes. Actually, they have been found to be involved in the embryogenesis, in apoptosis, cell differentiation, cell cycle control. There are many biological processes where these microRNAs have been found to be implicated. And if their dysregulation occurs, which will result in several diseases that can be cardiovascular disease, heart disease, or cancer, or, you know, it can lead to several, or neurological disorder, or several diseases can occur if there is any dysregulation that occurs in microRNA. So these microRNAs were first described in 1993 by Lee and colleagues. You know, this is what I wanted just to mention, that who for the first time described these microRNAs. Okay, so in the year 1993, Lee and colleagues, they described these microRNAs. Okay, so the synopsis of this slide is that microRNA are small endogenous non-coding RNA which are about 21 to 25 nucleotide in length, which are the master regulator of gene expression. And they were first described in the year 1993 by Lee and colleagues. Okay, so now here I'm going to talk about how the biogenesis of microRNA occurs. So the first important point is that microRNA, they have microRNA genes in the DNA. Okay, so this picture here, microRNA genes in the DNA, and these will be transcribed by RNA polymerase II. So microRNA genes will be transcribed by RNA polymerase II, and this will result in primary or primordial microRNA, which has stem loop structure, as you can see here, which is about 100 to 1000 base pair long. Okay, so from the microRNA genes by transcription by RNA polymerase II, that results in primary or primordial microRNA, which are about 100 to 1000 base pair long. And these primordial or primary microRNA will be recognized by BGCRF protein, and which will be further processed by RNA's third enzyme that is called drosha. Okay, so then these primordial microRNA will become shorter because they will cleave, and which now we will have precursor microRNA which is about 65 to 100 base pair long. So here, primary microRNA was about 100 to 1000 base pair long. By the action of drosha and DGCR8, we have precursor microRNA, which is about 165 to 100 base pair long. Okay? So all this process, the transcription of microRNA genes by RNA polymerase II and this action of drosha and DGCR8 on primordial microRNA, resulting in the formation of precursor microRNA, occurs in the nucleus. And from the nucleus, this precursor microRNA through the nuclear pore will be exported by exportin 5 and RAN GTP complex. So from the nucleus, the precursor microRNA will be exported to the cytoplasm by exportin 5 and RAN GTP complex. Now we have precursor microRNA in the cytoplasm, okay? And in the cytoplasm, this precursor microRNA, it will be recognized by another RNAs, which is type 3rd, that is called dicer, and it will cleave this further. And then we will have this duplex of microRNA. And there is one protein that is called argonaut protein. Argonaut protein will interact with these duplex, and this will unwind, and only one strand this red part here will be left with the something called risk complex. Okay, so what is risk? You can see here the name risk. Risk is RNA induced silencing complex. So this RNA induced silencing complex, this consists of argonaut protein and some other proteins plus this microRNA, which is the guide strand of the microRNA, okay, from only the guide strand. The other strand will be unwound from these two. This one will be unwound and it will be degraded, and we will be only left with the guide strand in the risk complex. Because this guide microRNA, it has complementary sequences to the 3' untranslated region of our target mRNA. So it will bind to the target mRNA at the 3' untranslated region, okay? So the function of this miRNA is to guide this risk complex to the target mRNA, because it will bind to the target mRNA and the risk complex will do its function. So two things can happen, okay? Two things can happen. One is mRNA decay, another one is translation inhibition, okay? So it depends on if the guide RNA has the perfect complementarity to the our target mRNA, okay, then this risk complex will cleave, you know, argonaut proteins specifically, they will cleave this coding protein coding part of our target mRNA into small pieces, and we should be further degraded, okay? So this will result in mRNA decay. Another thing is that if this guide RNA has partial complementarity to our target mRNA, okay? So guide microRNA, if our guide microRNA has partial complementarity to our target mRNA, then that will result in translation inhibition. How it will occur is that this risk complex will inhibit the ribosomal subunit to bind with this our target mRNA, so that the further protein synthesis cannot occur, okay? So here I want to explain this part here again. You see, we have our double-stranded guide microRNA and argonaut protein will interact, and the risk complex will only have the guide microRNA strand. The other strand will be degraded, and this guide microRNA will guide the risk complex to the target mRNA. Guide microRNA will guide the risk complex to the target microRNA, and two things can happen. One thing is decay of the target mRNA or the translation inhibition. Okay, when the decay occurs, if this guide microRNA strand has perfect complementarity to the 3' untranslated region, in that case, this risk complex will cleave our mRNA and protein synthesis can no longer occur. But if this is partial complementarity, okay, if the complementarity between 3' untranslated region of the target mRNA and microRNA strand is partial, then translation inhibition will occur. How that will occur? This risk complex will prevent ribosomal subunit to interact with our target mRNA. Hence, the protein synthesis cannot occur, because protein synthesis occurs in the ribosome. You know that, right? So this is how the gene will be silenced. So I want to show you here. For example, gene first has to go through the process of transcription and it becomes mRNA. And from the mRNA to be converted into the protein, you know, that process is called translation. From gene to mRNA is called transcription, and mRNA to protein is called translation. Here, what our microRNA has done is that it has not prevented from the gene to going into the mRNA, but it has prevented the gene from going from mRNA to the protein. Therefore, they have inhibited the translation process. Since the gene has been silenced, because for the gene to function, it must be converted to the protein. So if there is no protein, so the gene cannot function. So it has been silenced, okay? So this thing you should understand. So now we know that these microRNAs have play a very important role in silencing of the genes. And like I said before, they have regulatory functions. And I want to mention here that in humans, these microRNA can regulate up to 30% of the genes. 30% of the genes in human are regulated by microRNA. So therefore, they are very, very important. If their dysregulation occurs, that can result in several diseases. And that's why these microRNA have also been, implicated in the medicine. Thank you very much.